Well, hello everybody, and welcome to this month's Crafternoons session, where we will be learning all about the mythology and folklore of the Philippines. So, my name is Tatiana Beck. I am going to be our moderator for this session. I am one of the education coordinators from the Museum of Antiquities, and I am going to be joined here by our craft master, William Carlson, who is going to be telling us a lot of what he knows about folklore, stories, and monsters from the Philippines. And he will also be taking us through an exciting craft related to Bakunawa, who is a mythical dragon in Filipino folklore. So first things first, hopefully you guys should have all of your craft equipment ready if you are going to be partaking in that. So the first thing I would like you to do is make sure you have all that ready to go. We have a post up with all of the craft instructions and all items that you will need up on our WordPress blog. And that is accessible through the Facebook event page for this craft for noon, as well as on both the Ancient and Medieval Adventures and Museum of Antiquities Facebook pages. This session will be live streamed to Facebook, and that will stay up over the next couple of days so that people can go back and join the session if they would like to. And it will also be going up on YouTube in just a couple of weeks, where people will be able to join afterwards and follow along with our presenter and with our craft. So what I'm going to do to get us started is I am going to pass us off to William Carlson, who is going to tell us a little bit more about what we're going to be focusing on today.
Thank you very much, Tatiana. That was a wonderful introduction. Hello, kumusta? Welcome everyone to our Ancient and Medieval Adventures Crafternoon. It's fantastic that you'll be able to join us today. Today we're going to be talking about some tales from the Philippines. For those of you who aren't familiar with what the Philippines are, they are a collection of over 7,000 islands located in a junction between Oceania, Southeast Asia, and Indonesia. These islands are home to dozens of different tribes with their own languages, cultural traditions, myths, and identities. There are well over 120 distinct languages spoken in the Philippines and over 175 ethno-linguistic nations. The story that we're going to be sharing today comes from the Bisayan, the central sort of archipelago in the Philippines, the Bisayas, and it's about the Bakunawa. Bakunawa is a large dragon-like creature that we will be talking about. It's fairly common in most Filipino folklore, though it goes by different names and has different myths and stories associated with it. Before we launch into that, though, we should make sure that we have all of our craft supplies that we're going to be needing for this. So what we're going to be doing is we're going to actually be starting off by looking at an example of the craft we're going to be making. So switching down to my, switching down to my craft cam here, I'm going to show you guys this wonderful craft that we'll be working on this afternoon. So here we have our Bakunawa, and as you can see, as a part of this craft, they are going to be eating the moon. So this is part of the legend that we're going to be talking about today, which is why the Bakunawa is associated with lunar and sometimes solar eclipses, and how the Filipino folklore talks about this and how it's influenced some of the language and the culture of the Philippines. Now, just popping back up to my normal camera. So again, for this craft, you're going to need a few different materials. First of all, you're going to need three black sheets of paper. I'm using black construction paper. You can use cardstock or other types of paper if you so desire, but I find construction paper has worked the best for me. You're also going to need our eclipse templates, which you can find online. Those include our template of the moon, our traceable pullout tab, a glue stick, pair of scissors, our star sheet, and there should be a printable PDF image of your Bakunawa, which should look like this, however, uncolored. I am going to be using this one, which I prepared earlier for my demonstrations, but that's what you should all have handy for today's craft. Now, before we begin, I'm going to just, those of you who are following along for today's craft, take out your Bakunawa template page, which is the one with the iho, the Bakunawa, the dragon serpent on it, and you're going to start coloring that in. So it can be any color you want. We don't have to pick a certain specific color. The one that I have here, as you all saw, is a wonderful combination of greens and blues with a little bit of red just to sort of make them look a little bit more fearsome. But you can really pick whichever colors that you would associate with your sea serpent Bakunawa dragon. So while you're starting to color that in, I'm gonna sort of do a little bit of sharing, if that's okay. My mother is originally from the Philippines. She was born in Quezon City, right outside Manila. And I haven't been to the Philippines myself yet. I'd love to go someday, but I haven't had the opportunity. However, I do have a few stories that I've heard. And before we launch into today's Bakunawa story, I thought it'd be nice to talk a little bit about some of the things that I've heard about. Now, because the Philippines are so complicated, there's so many different people, there are so many different stories, and thanks to that, they have hundreds and hundreds of monsters and deities and spirits and elves and all sorts of very interesting creatures in their folklore and their mythology. One that I am most familiar with that I've heard many stories about is the duende. Duende are a type of, you call them an elf, kind of like a gnome. They're little people who live under rocks and trees and mostly like to keep to themselves, according to Filipino mythology. And one story that I always heard growing up was from my great-grandmother and my Lola, my grandma. They would say that there was, they'd tell the story about how they had this big boulder at the front of their house that a duende lived under. And if you came too close to it or you started messing around near that duende's boulder, they had this cane, this little bamboo rod, and they would smack you with it across the shins if you were misbehaving and if you're starting to bother them. So they're not like European fairies. They're a little bit more violent, you might say. But it's interesting that they mention in this story having bamboo or cane sticks, because something that's very common in the Philippines, well, not so much nowadays, but I'm sure some of you have heard of these, are kali sticks. So this is my set of kali sticks, which I use when I practice arnesa escrima, or kali, a pair of rattan fighting sticks. They're very loud if you smack them together, but it's a type of woody reed, sort of like bamboo. And you'll probably recognize them from superhero movies or TV shows. Robin from Batman and Robin fights with kali sticks. So does Kato from The Green Hornet. And a lot of other famous superheroes and martial artists use Filipino kali sticks and Filipino knife fighting. It's a part of their cultural heritage. It's managed to make its way into common cinema. Another interesting thing from the Philippines that we'll be talking about a little bit later is the prevalence of bamboo and sugarcane and these woody, reedy plants that sort of fill up the jungle. The Philippines are a tropical island archipelago, so of course there's going to be a lot of heavy, dense underbrush you have to deal with. And something that's required there, of course, then is a machete or a bolo. Now this is mine. I'm just going to turn off my background for a second so we can all take a quick look at it. But this is a Filipino bolo. This one here, when I got it, it's called the Katipunan, named after the freedom fighters from the Philippines. The Philippines are very freedom fighting. They've been attacked and invaded by people throughout history. And this long sword-like bolo is actually traditionally or originally meant for cutting through sugarcane. But the Filipinos used it for war as well. It's very dangerous, it's very sharp, and it's very heavy in the front, so it's good for chopping. It's interesting because one thing that we will learn about during our story of the Bakunawa is how one of the tales tell about the moon being covered in bamboo to help keep the Bakunawa away. And bolo, the Katipunan, can cut through bamboo pretty well, but you have to take a good few swings at it. So it's interesting to think that if the Bakunawa is going to be biting through bamboo to get to the moon, well, how big are its teeth going to have to be for that? It's pretty sizable, I'd say. But enough talks about weapons and fighting. We are here to tell stories. So the story that I'm going to tell today, I'm sure you've all guessed, is about the Bakunawa, also called the Laho in Tagalog. This mythological creature is described in many ways, with each region of the Philippines telling a different story. In one region, the Bakunawa is described as an immortal god. In another, they're a giant sea creature. Both men, male and female, stories of the Bakunawa exist. Sometimes it's described as a giant snake, a crocodile, a lion, a bird, or a dragon, depending on where you're asking, or giant birds that have etymological or linguistic connections to the Bakunawa exist as well. The Bakunawa eats the moon, and then giant bird would eat the sun. So it's very complicated and very complex to try to research all these different stories. But what all these have in common is that the Bakunawa always tries to eat the moon during a lunar eclipse. Now, for those of you who might be younger or haven't ever witnessed a lunar eclipse, I'm going to just show you here. So we all know how the moon changes from full to new, right? It gets bigger and smaller. It appears and disappears. Well, on a lunar eclipse, the moon disappears and then reappears in a single night, usually over a period of just a couple hours, sometimes minutes if you're on for a quick one. But the Filipinos, ancient Filipinos, believed that this appearance and disappearance of the moon was due to Bakunawa, who would devour it and then spit it back up. We know now that the Earth blocks light from the sun that's shining on the moon at night, and as a result, it appears to disappear or change color. But the ancient Filipinos believed that this was the Bakunawa, and the word laho is still connected to the idea of disappearance in Tagalog. So it's an interesting thing. So you've all had a little bit of time to sort of work on coloring in your Bakunawa now. So the next step before we begin our story is I'm going to have you guys cut out your moon template. So for this, before we jump in, you're going to take your picture of the moon here. You're going to take a pair of safety scissors, or you're going to ask a parent, guardian, or older sibling for help if you're young still or you're not allowed to use scissors. And we are going to very carefully cut out our moon. We're just going to go right around the edge very gently. While we're cutting this out, I want you to think about any other myths and legends that any of you might know from the Philippines or what you know about the Philippines. I've heard stories of shamans from the Philippines, people who interact with animal spirits. I've heard stories of giant crocodiles that would wait in rivers to munch people. I'm not sure if those are so much legends and stories as just very unfortunate happenings. There are very big crocodiles in the Philippines. I've heard stories of giants that sit in trees and they spook small children and send them home if the kids are out after dark, because they're capri. I've heard some scary stories too about vampires and shapeshifters, but we're not going to talk about those today. Those are pretty spooky. Now, we've cut out our moon. Take your time. I went pretty quick on that. Take your time cutting it and then put it down into the side. While I tell the rest of the story, what you guys are going to be doing is a couple quick steps. You're going to take a piece of black construction paper. And you're going to take your moon and put it on your construction paper like so. And you're then going to take a pen or pencil. I'm using a white crayon. And you're going to put your moon in the very middle of this black piece of paper. And you're going to trace around it. This is very important to do so that you can make your eclipse template. We're just going to take our time working all the way around it, just like that. Down the other side. It's interesting talking about the myths and legends of the Philippines, because there have been so many people who have come to the Philippines over the years. We have myths in the Philippines that are connected to Islam and Hinduism and Buddhism and Christianity and Catholicism. There are so many stories now. So we have stories of people who believe in jinn, and people who believe in angels, and people who believe in different Hindu gods, and the Bakunawa can sometimes be associated with some Hindu deities. It's very interesting. Now, before we move on, now I'm just going to do one final step. What we're going to do here, while you guys are telling your story, is you're going to very carefully, or while I'm telling a story, you are going to very carefully sort of pinch your paper and cut a hole right in the middle of what you've cut out, just like that. So there's a little hole there. And you are going to go all the way up to the edge, just there, and then cut out the hole. This can be a little tricky, so take your time. But the idea is to cut out the hole in the center without cutting out your entire paper. So you just want a hole in the middle without cutting the paper through. You don't want to cut in half or something. After you do that, you should have a nice hole in the middle of your page, and you're going to use your tab sheet and another piece of paper, and you're going to do something very similar. You're going to cut this out. You're going to put it on the black paper, you're going to trace it, and then you're going to cut it out. And when you're finished, you should have a nice little black tab all cut and ready to go. So I'm going to let you guys do that while I tell this story. Put my background back on. There we are. So, while you guys are doing that, we're going to talk about the story of the Bakunawa and the seven moons. for this, I have a little pat board for us that I'm going to use to tell today's story. So Filipino culture is very complicated and very diverse. As I mentioned before, the Philippines is not made up of a single people, but rather hundreds of distinct and diverse cultures, languages, tribes, and ethnicities. To make things even more complex, the Philippines have been influenced by numerous people over the centuries. And Filipino language, legends, cultures all reflect the influences of Hinduism, Islam, Christianity, and Catholicism, Buddhism, as well as multiple exchanges of myths and cultures with their Southeast Asian, Polynesian, and Indonesian neighbors. Throughout all of this, though, the Philippines still hold a strong sense of identity and a unique people onto themselves. They've survived invasions, colonizations, and wars with people who wanted to take over their islands for thousands of years, including wars with fellow islanders, Spain, China, Japan, the United States, and many other nations. Thanks to this rich history, we have an insane amount that we can learn about the Philippines. And this story that we're going to share today is just one tiny piece of this amazing tapestry. A quick example of some of this cultural exchange is the inclusion of Hindu words such as Naga in the Filipino language. Naga is a Hindu word for a snake person. The North Island is also strongly Christianized, and the South has many Muslim people in it. The clothing, culture, and traditions of many Filipino groups have seen influence from their neighbors, and whether those be the modern westernization of the Philippines or earlier, more ancient influences. So all that aside, we're going to launch into the story that I have been promising you all, and it has taken us a hot minute to get to. I apologize. So, here we go. In order to light up the sky at night, the creator god, Batala, this lovely gentleman right here, created not only a single moon that we know today, but seven moons. One moon to light up each night of the week. The seven moons made the sky bright and beautiful, and they were beloved by the people for keeping away the darkness. But these humans were not the only ones who thought the moons were beautiful. There was also Bakunawa, a giant serpent-like dragon who saw the moons shining in the sky and became envious of them, wanting to have them for himself. One night, Bakunawa rose from the sea into the sky, by the way around, and opened his mouth as wide as a lake to swallow the first moon. Satisfied, he returned to his home in the water with the moon, and it lit up his home beautifully. However, after a little while, the moon melted, and he decided that he wanted to steal. Again, Bakunawa rose up into the sky and devoured a second moon, and returned home to the water till the moon he had devoured once again melted away. He did this four more times, until there was only a single moon left. The people of the Philippines noticed the moons disappearing and became frightened. They did not want their beloved moon to disappear, leaving the night entirely dark. When Bakunawa next tried to rise up and devour the moon, the people came out of their homes, gathering drums and instruments and pots and pans and rattan sticks and all sorts of things to make as much noise as they could. Bakunawa began to slowly eat the moon, creating a lunar eclipse. And in response, people began to bang their pots and pans and shout at the moon, at Bakunawa, to leave the moon alone. Bakunawa became so frightened of the noise that he spit the moon back out and ran away, ending the lunar eclipse and returning the moon to the people. All of the noise from the night alerted Batala, and the people of the Philippines to the problem of the disappearing moon. In order to keep Bakunawa from devouring the final moon, Batala planted bamboo all around it. From far away, this bamboo looked like stains on the moon, giving it this pockmarked appearance. The moon was protected by Batala, and the people of the Philippines were happy. However, every now and again, Bakunawa returns to try to eat the final moon, which once again results in a lunar eclipse. Even to this day, some regions of the Philippines, people will gather during a lunar eclipse to create noise that will keep Bakunawa from completing this task. And that, ladies and gentlemen, everyone else, is our story of Bakunawa and the Seven Moons. I hope you enjoyed it. Now, before we go back to our craft, does anyone have any questions?
All right. I will get us started. We are going to get started on our Q&A section now. First of all, thank you so much, William, for telling that awesome story. I'm very excited to get to the part of our craft where we get to recreate the Bakunawa eating the moon. But I would love to start with a couple of questions before we do that. I have a couple of questions ready for you. But if anyone else who is here with us today has any other questions, feel free to slip them into the chat. And William will do his best to answer them for you as well. So you guys can keep working on coloring out those elements and tracing and cutting out your circle on your construction paper. And I will get started with my questions. So the first one that I wanted to ask you, William, is in this story, you mentioned that the people of the Philippines used different kinds of instruments and noisemakers in order to scare away Bakunawa and keep him from eating the moon. So what kinds of instruments do people in the Philippines generally use?
There are a number of different instruments found in the Philippines. If we're talking specifically about Bisayan, some of the common indigenous instruments are a type of quiet lute, which is a long sort of guitar-like instrument. It's very thin and has multiple strings, and you strum it and you pick it like a lute. They also have a bamboo zither, which if any of you have seen Chinese or Japanese musical performances, it's a long board, sort of with a resonance chamber inside that has strings all across the top of it that you can pluck. They also have nose flutes, reed mouth harps. There is also bamboo and seashell bugles in the Philippines. You know, we all, as kids, you pick up a large seashell and you blow into it and it acts like a trumpet. There are also metal gongs, drums, and bamboo resonators, which are, you take a bamboo piece, you make sure it's hollow, and then you cut into it a few slats. And when you strike it, it works sort of like a drum. So those are a couple of the instruments that we find in the Philippines.
Very cool, William. Thank you for answering that question. It sounds like bamboo is something that's quite important in Filipino culture, huh?
Absolutely. It's you find it in musical instruments, you find it in the architecture, you find it in dances. There are dances that use large bamboo staves, you could say, and people dance over them as they smash into each other and on the ground. It's a very common resource in the Philippines, and it's been used to full effect.
Yeah. Awesome. Well, it also obviously plays an important part in our story, where Bathala places it in front of the moon, creating that pockmarked appearance as part of protecting the moon from Bakunawa. So it sounds like something about Filipino folklore and mythology that you might see often is that these stories serve to explain something that happens in the natural world. So Bakunawa creates eclipses or has sometimes ties to other weather events. The bamboo shows kind of how the moon came to look like it does. Is that something that's typical of Filipino folklore?
Yeah, there's a lot of explanatory power that's wrapped up in Filipino folklore. There's a lot of stories of why a volcano is spewing smoke and it's due to a monster that lives in the volcano, or why people would get sick, or why certain animals would act one way or another, or why you might hear a scary noise at night. A lot of these folklore tales from the Philippines serve to explain these experiences and the sort of things that you would witness living in the Philippines. Yeah.
Awesome.
The Philippines
Go ahead.
Sure. Thank you. The Philippines has a indigenous belief system that is anitism, which is a combination of sort of animistic shamanic beliefs with spirits that inhabit different aspects of the natural world alongside monsters and people, and then a ancestral worship system as well. So it's very spiritual. It has a lot to do with different souls, you might say, or different spirits or different essences inhabiting aspects of the natural world. So you get a lot of that in the folklore.
So do the Philippines have pantheons of gods in the same way as something like a Greek or Roman pantheon might have?
Yeah, you could say that. It's hard to, they definitely have a pantheon of gods and monsters that inhabit roles similar to what you would see in the Greek or Roman or Norse pantheons. You have creators and you have celestial bodies and different deities that sort of rule over the heavens. But this isn't something that you would say was sort of pan-Filipino. There are certain indigenous groups in the Philippines that don't believe in this. There are some that believe in specifically monotheistic deities like the Islamic or Christian gods, or they believe in the multiple deistic pantheon that was brought over with Hinduism. So it's complicated, and you get combinations and variations of all of these different influences as well.
All right. Well, on that note, obviously you've mentioned that there are a lot of different cultures in the Philippines, a lot of different groups and tribes. Mm-hmm. So you mentioned the Visaya, who were the ones that the story of Bakunawa that we read today came from. Mm-hmm. Are you able to tell us a little bit more about who some of the other tribes might have been, or maybe tell us a little bit more about the Visaya themselves?
Sure, yeah. So the people who live in Visayan are the Cebuano. And it's a name that comes from Cebu, which is one of the largest centers and the linguistic center of Visayan. If you're talking specifically about some of the different indigenous tribes, there are, like I said, hundreds. You have up north, you have different groups like the Igorot, and you have Lumad in the south. But even then, like, these tribal groups aren't simply like one tribe. The Lumad, for instance, in the south have 13 different ethnic groups comprising them. Or you have the Bajau from Mindanao. They used to be sea folk. They would live in houseboats along the coast, but They've mostly moved abroad now. They've gone to, many of them have moved to Manila, or you see them living in Indonesia and other parts of the world. The Bisayas have the Ati and the Tumadok. In the south, you also have like Palawan tribes. And it's just, there are huge numbers of different people in the Philippines, and they each have different sort of reputations and cultural markers associated with them. Broadly speaking, in the north, like the Igorot and other northern tribes are associated with headhunting, which is sort of like their like a stereotype and a claim to fame amongst Filipinos. And then in the south, where you find a lot of Islamic influences and other groups down there, you have indigenous groups that are supposed to be like really fierce warriors, from what I've been told from my family in the Philippines, at least. And then in the middle, you have, you know, the Manggian and different groups of that who are supposed to be like super peaceful and stuff. But then, you know, you have, of course, these are broad generalizations, and you have people who are from peaceful groups who carry swords, and people who are supposed to be headhunters who would, you know, like to sit down and have tea. And it's very complicated.
Awesome. Well, it sounds like this is just the tip of the iceberg on Filipino folklore, and kind of the cultures that are represented there. So hopefully one day we can get a couple more Crafternoon sessions going where we learn different things about the Philippines. But without further ado, I would like to make sure you guys have enough time to get to the rest of the eclipse craft. So I will let you guys continue to recreate the story of Bakunawa and the seven moons before we finish wrapping up for the day.
Fantastic. Thank you. All right. So as we pop back into our craft, just want to see how everyone is doing with this. We're going to be taking our moon here. And for our next step, I have overlaid this cutout that we've all made, and I put it on top of a full black piece of construction paper. Now, once those are nicely lined up, our next step is going to be to take out a handy dandy glue stick and just make sure that, oh, we're almost out of glue. Well, good thing we're doing the craft now. And we're just going to add some glue onto, come back here, glue. We're just gonna add some glue onto this sheet of paper. And then we're gonna take the moon that we cut out earlier, and we're gonna put it through the hole onto the paper like so. I'm gonna push that down, pat, pat, make sure it's nice and in place. Wonderful. Then we're going to take our glue stick once again and get a little more glue out of that. Oh, we're nearly out. We'll be all right, though. And we are going to add some glue to this back sheet. Now, this is very important. We're going to go across the top, then across one side, then we're going to go across the bottom. Now, it's very important that we keep this side open. We don't add any glue onto that. But once you've glued those on, and put the glue there, you're going to take your piece of paper with the hole cut through it, and you're going to glue it on top. Now, I'm going to pat that down nice and gently. Just like that. And this side should remain nice and open. Now, the reason for this is that when you have your black paper cut out, you'll be able to insert it just like an envelope and make your moon disappear, just like so. Ta-da! And thus we have a solar eclipse. Now, once you've glued this all together, we get to have the fun part. For us, that is going to be carefully cutting out our Bakunawa, a pair of scissors, and gluing it onto our pullout tab here. So we're going to take some time to just very carefully cut it out. We're not going to rush. We're going to be nice and careful. We're going to slowly go around the edges. Be careful as we go over the top here. We don't want to cut through his fins. And we're going to work our way around the Bakunawa. Then we're going to take our glue sticks again, or our white glue, or our tape, or whatever we might be using. And we're going to add some glue, some tape, some adhesive onto the back of our Bakunawa, onto the part you haven't colored yet. And you're going to stick that right onto your tab so that when you stick your tab into your envelope like that, your Bakunawa devours the moon. Just like so. Now, the final part of this project, once you finish that, take our time with it though, I'm just letting you know what we're doing next, is we have all of these wonderful stars. Mm-hmm. We're going to take our scissors, very handy. We're going to cut out just a few. We don't need to cut all of them out if you don't want to, but you definitely can. I'm just going to cut out a couple here while you guys glue down your Bakunawas. Put that aside. I'm going to take this and cut that in half. I'm going to start on this big star. And we're just going to very carefully cut them out. Now, I mentioned before that in different parts of the Philippines, they have different stories about Bakunawa. One of these is the Bicolano have their own version of the Bakunawa myth. And in this version of the myth, Bakunawa is actually a woman. And what happens is that instead of being a greedy man who just wants the moons for himself, there's only one moon. But Bakunawa fell madly in love with the moon. The moon was a beautiful young man. And unfortunately, the moon didn't love Bakunawa back. Although she asked him for his love many times, he said no. She got very sad and very upset by this. So she tried to turn into a dragon and eat him so that he would be with her forever. What happened, though, was that the moon's sister, Alia, fought off Bakunawa to protect her brother. And it's when she fights off Bakunawa that the moon is returned after an eclipse. And I think that's a pretty interesting version of the story. As when we get very emotional, when we're in love, or if someone hurts our feelings, sometimes we do stuff that we regret, right? Bakunawa is very heartbroken. And that's not her fault. But she got a little too attached to the moon. And what she did trying to eat him, trying to possess him, wasn't right. She should have respected the fact that he said no and let it go like that. But luckily, the moon has a wonderful sister who protects him from Bakunawa. So it's always good to have people, whether they be friends or siblings, that you can rely on and who will take care of you. Because sometimes we all need a little help, just like the moon. Whether Bakunawa is trying to eat the moon because she's possessive, or whether Bakunawa is trying to eat the moon because he's greedy, or whatever the reason, the Filipinos come out and they they shout at Bakunawa and they send him or her home without eating the moon, because the moon doesn't belong to any one person. Just like none of us belong to any one person. So it's always good to have someone that will help you out when you need a hand, when you're dealing with rough times, whether that be a sea dragon or tough exams. This is a hard time of year for a lot of kids dealing with school and the way the world is right now. And there we have another little star. Cut out one more, I think. So back when I was trying to eat that star. As I mentioned before, though, there are many gods and spirits in Filipino culture. One group of these has Batala as the leader. He's the one who created the moon in the story that we heard today. And then we have Apolaki and Mayari, who rule the sun and the moon. Mayari is actually supposed to be the moon itself in this version of the story. So we have lots of different legends that tell us about the sun and moon. Then we have Amian, who's the first creature in the universe. They're a bird. It's pretty cool. We also have different legends about the Marias. The Marias are three different mountains. We have Makiling, Sinukualan, and Kakao, who are all different mountains, the three Marias. And we, of course, have Bakunawa, who is sometimes a dragon, sometimes a woman, sometimes the god of the underworld, which isn't a bad person, sort of like the Greek Hades. That version of Bakunawa isn't a bad person. They just happen to be the god of the underworld. And we should appreciate that job. It's not a job that everyone wants, and it's important that we respect people who have jobs that we don't want to do. And usually when Bakunawa is the god of the underworld, he's the rival of Batala. And that's sort of the Tagalog pantheon there. So when you guys are finished cutting out your stars, you can add a little bit of glue onto the back of them. And you can glue those down around the outside. Don't put them on your Bakunawa. I mean, you could if you wanted to. There's nothing stopping you from putting them on your Bakunawa. I put them around the outside edge of my moon. And then when you're all finished up, you'll have a nice one like this, which I made earlier. Sort of like prepping a cake before you do your baking show. And you can put your Bakunawa inside. And just like that, Bakunawa devours the moon. So there you have it. And that's our craft for today. It's a lovely little craft. Now then. Before we close up, I wanted to take a second to thank everyone for joining us for today. This is all I have to tell you guys about right now, but I hope to come back someday and we can talk more about some Filipino history and folklore. There are lots of games that I learned growing up from my Filipino family that I would love to teach you all someday. Games like Sungka, other ones which are sort of like board games, very, very fun. I spent a lot of time playing those as a kid. But I hope that today we all learned a little something about the mythology and the folklore of the Philippines. Before I go, please remember to take some pictures of your completed crafts. I'd love to see how they all turned out. You can send those to the Museum of Antiquities via our Facebook page. And you can check out our WordPress blog if you want to see how to make some more of these, if you have friends or a sibling or your parents want to make one. Now, before we go, please remember the myths and stories of the Philippines reflect a complex, rich, and varied group of cultures that make up hundreds of peoples across thousands of islands. And there's so much more to discover and learn about them than I could ever cover in one brief afternoon. I encourage everyone to do their own research about the Philippines, to ask Filipino elders and seniors in your communities about the Philippines, because there's so much to learn, and it's such an interesting and a complicated group of cultures that I really can't do credit to it here. But with all that aside, thank you for joining us for this Ancient and Medieval Adventures Crafternoon. If you're looking for fun content over the summer, you can please check out our website for information about our Camp in a Box program, which is like a summer camp in the comfort of your own home. So with that, I will pass you back to Tatiana, and have a good day.
Perfect. Well, thank you so much, William. I would give you a big round of applause, but it's just me, so that won't sound very exciting. But we're super excited that we got the chance to talk with you about Filipino folklore, and that you could take some time today to share some stuff about your culture and kind of the stories that your family have told you in the past. Like William says, we have a lot of fun summer camp content coming up. We are in the process of putting out registration for our new summer camp adventures packs, which will be, like William said, those packs that you can do at home that will include content from 3 to 4 of our different ancient and medieval adventures camps. So registration will be going out beginning in May for those, and we'll make sure that you guys get a whole bunch of details on what that's going to look like. They're going to be super exciting. This session, as I said earlier, we'll be going up on YouTube if you guys need to come back to follow along for any parts of the craft, or if there's something you need to double check on what the next step is. And we are super excited to get to see your guys' creations if you guys choose to send them in. So have a wonderful rest of your Saturday and a great weekend. And we look forward to telling you more about what future sessions we're going to have to offer soon. Have a good one, everybody.